Hi there, and welcome to my monthly astronomy update from my Astroform channel. This time the update will be exclusively about the largest planet of our solar system, Jupiter, and one of its moons, Europa. In this Jupiter exclusive astronomy update, I will talk to you about an amateur astrographer who catched a meteor crash on Jupiter. New Hubble pictures confirm that red spot is getting smaller. Also, new science models show that Jupiter could be hit by a massive celestial body in its early formation, based on the data that Juno has been collecting. And finally, NASA confirmed the Europa Clipper mission to launch in 2024. If you like the content, please consider subscribing to my channel, and by hitting the notification button, you will be getting updates on all of my latest videos. So let's get into it. Ethan Chappell captured a meteor impact on Jupiter with nothing more than his backyard telescope. This is very exciting. He used a Celestron C8 Smith Cassegrain on a Celestron Advanced VX mount, and actually I have a similar mount. He also used a ZWO ASI 290 mono camera. And he was able to compile the images into this short moving you are seeing right now, showing the apparent moment of impact with a bright flash in the southern equatorial belt. The flash only lasts a couple of moments before fading, which is typical of a meteor impact. The fact that Jupiter gets hit by meteors in itself is not so strange, but estimations are that Jupiter is probably hit several times a year. However, capturing such events is pretty rare. And of course, one of the more memorable impacts was the comet Shoemaker-Levy 25 years ago. In 1994, 21 fragments of this comet crashed into Jupiter, producing energy that was comparable to about 300 million atom bombs. Those fragments created enormous plumes of gas that were visible for many months before being blown away by Jupiter's storms. And of course, as you know, Jupiter is the most massive planet of our solar system. The gravity of Jupiter is about 2.5 times of what it is here on Earth. It is therefore believed that Jupiter prevents a lot of meteors and comets from moving into our inner solar system to threaten our own beautiful planet. We have seen the potential risk that a meteor impact could cause with just a small meteor exploding about 30 kilometers above the Russian city of Chelyabinsk in 2015. The explosion generated a bright flash, producing a hot cloud of dust and gas that penetrated to 26 kilometers, or 60 miles, producing many small fragmentary meteorites as well as a large shockwave. And the total kinetic energy of that impact was equivalent to about 30 times the energy released from the atomic bomb. So, thank you Jupiter for saving our butts one more time. So next, Hubble recently released new pictures of Jupiter. Among the most striking features in the image are the rich colors of clouds moving towards the Great Red Spot, a beautiful sight. As you probably know, the Red Spot is a storm rolling counterclockwise between two bands of clouds. These two cloud bands, above and below the Great Red Spot, are moving in opposite directions. The bands are separated by winds that can reach speeds up to 400 miles or 644 kilometers per hour. The Great Red Spot has been observed since the invention of the telescope. It's probably observed systematically for the first time in 1665 by Giovanni Cassini. And in the 21st century, the Great Red Spot was seen shrinking in size. At the start of 2004, the Great Red Spot had approximately half the longitudinal extent it had a century ago, when it reached a size of 40,000 kilometers or 25,000 miles, which is about two times the diameter of Earth. At the present rate of reduction, it would become circular by 2040. It is not known how long the Great Red Spot will last or whether the change is a result of normal fluctuations. Interestingly, this is also something we could observe ourselves as amateur astrographers from our own backyard, so this is very exciting. So next, Juno data confirmed that Jupiter does not have a stable but a fuzzy core. And that is pretty surprising, because scientists actually thought that Jupiter either would harbor a relatively compact core, 1 to 10 times as massive as Earth, or would have no core whatsoever. But neither of these hypotheses appears to fit the gravity data collected so far by the Juno spacecraft. And as you might know, Juno has been orbiting Jupiter in a highly elliptical orbit since July 2016. It passes Jupiter at perigee, so at the lowest point, every 53 days. The initial plan was actually to do 14-day flybys with this spacecraft, but due to some technical concerns, it was decided to leave the spacecraft at the present highly elliptical orbit. Juno has actually 8 science instruments to study Jupiter's structure, composition, gravitational and magnetic fields. And yeah, the data suggests that instead of a small compact core, Juno data shows that Jupiter would have a dilute fuzzy core that extends to almost half its radius. And yeah, there have been scientists working on figuring out how this core came to be. And Shengfei Liu, if I pronounce his name correctly, and his team of scientists recently published an article in Nature where they explained a scenario where 4.5 billion years ago, at the creation of our own solar system, a massive planetary embryo about one-third the size of Jupiter could have collided with Jupiter, producing this fuzzy core. And yeah, after the impact, Jupiter's primordial compact core would have been completely destroyed due to that impact, and a dilute core-like structure could have been formed, according to Liu and his team. And this would explain why Jupiter would have gotten this fuzzy core, as observed by the Juno data. So the final update I want to share with you is that NASA confirmed that the Europa Clipper mission will move to its next phase. This decision allows the mission to progress to completion of the final design, followed by the construction and testing of the Europa Clipper spacecraft and its science payload. Now, this is very exciting news, as it brings us one step closer to unlocking the mysteries of Europa as one of the 4 big moons orbiting Jupiter. The most exciting part of this mission, in my opinion at least, is that the Europa Clipper spacecraft may be able to take measurements which may confirm if the subsurface ocean of Europa may be suitable for life. And you might think, how can this be done? Because yeah, you have to drill through a thick layer of ice to get to the subsurface ocean of Europa. But as you might have heard, the Hubble Space Telescope, it observed water vapor above the South Polar region of Europa back in 2012 already, and this observation, it provides potential evidence of water plumes that go out into space from the surface of Europa. And if those plumes' existence are actually confirmed and they are actually linked to the subsurface ocean, studying their composition will help scientists to investigate the chemical makeup of Europa's potentially habitable environment while minimizing the need to drill through layers of ice. And the Europa Clipper could do this by simply flying through such an eruption of water to collect samples. Now, during the mission, the spacecraft will perform 45 flybys of Europa at approach altitudes varying from 1700 miles to 60 miles, or 2700 kilometers to 25 kilometers above the surface of Europa. And such an elliptical path, it also protects the spacecraft from Jupiter's radiation. It's also being done in the Juno mission. And yeah, it is otherwise, this spacecraft would have to deal with a lot of radiation when being in a circular orbit closer to Europa. It also provides enough time between each pass to transmit the necessary data back to Earth. And yeah, this mission is scheduled to last 3.5 years. So this means that the spacecraft will pass Europa at perigee, its closest point of 25 kilometers, about once every 28 days, so we would get an update once every month. So one final interesting point about this specific mission is that NASA plans to launch the Europa Clipper spacecraft in June 2023 with its new space launch system. This rocket would be powerful enough to put the spacecraft on a direct path to Jupiter, which greatly reduces the travel time to less than 3 years, because the spacecraft would not need any gravity assist from other celestial bodies. So as a comparison, the ESA also plans to launch its own JUICE spacecraft to study the moons of Jupiter with its own JUICE mission. However, the plan is to launch a spacecraft in 2022 on an Ariane rocket, which is much less powerful as compared to what the SLS would be. And as a consequence, the spacecraft would have to follow a 7.5 year trajectory to Jupiter, which includes gravitational assists from Earth, Venus and Mars. The final arrival date of JUICE would then be at October 2029, so there is a big difference. However, the big question is, of course, if NASA can get the SLS ready to fly in 2023. NASA aims to launch its first iteration of the SLS in 2020, but yeah, there have been a lot of delays already on completing the space launch system. And we know that NASA is already working on this system since 2011, so that is something that we have to watch. And yeah, maybe it's a good thing that there is a certain water cooler from SpaceX flying around on a Raptor engine, which may in time provide a cost-effective alternative to the SLS system. And with that, we're at the end of this month's astronomy update. As always, thanks for watching, and I wish you clear skies.